Hi, this is Mad Cat, and I'm coming to you today because I just saw an article that came out on September 19th, 2013. And the article really shocked me. And I wanted to go ahead, I didn't read all of it, but I want to go ahead and read it like line by line to you and give you my reactions on it. So the article is titled, Six Sexist Video Game Problems Even Bigger Than the Breasts. Really? So starting off, some video games are more obviously focused on women's genitals than a gynecologist exam. When was the last time you saw a vagina in a video game? Now, I've seen boobs in a video game, but I don't remember the last time I actually saw a girl spread her legs apart and her vagina be right there. If there is such a game, please link it down below. I'd like to check it out. Now, in games like Terra, a woman's armor is mapped of her erogenous zones, defending her from only the most technical definition of nudity. Well, I kind of have to give them that because, you know, a joke in the geek community is that the less a woman wears in body armor, the more protected she is. So it's a valid point. Dead or Alive uses more computer power to model Kasumi's breasts than the NASA had for moon landings. That is actually not a joke. That actually is a joke. Because most modern devices, I mean, I'm talking like 99.9999999999% of all technology today is so much more powerful than the computer system, software, and hardware than what was found on the Apollo shuttles, the Apollo rockets. They were running at a little, and when I say little, I mean little, above 1 megahertz in processing speed, and that was their navigational computer. To give you some idea of what that number really means, is that we measure things in gigahertz. My current computer is running at 2.9 gigahertz Core 2 Duo, meaning two CPUs stacked on top of each other. Actually, I think it's like 2.93, but, and that's gigahertz, and I'm talking 1 megahertz. Your flip phone is more powerful. My keyboard piano is more powerful. This video camera is more powerful. This headset that I'm using as a microphone is more powerful than that. So this is a bad argument. It's like saying, oh, well, we should have less than 1 megahertz to do fluid dynamics for a girl's breast in a fighting game. Yeah, it's a little bit of fan service because mostly boys are playing fighting games, but I'm sure there are some women out there that enjoy it as well. Yes, it's a little sexist, but in a way, it's kind of supposed to be. You can't use this to judge women's sexual right in video games. Actually use games that support your opinion. Don't attack something like this and say, well, they have boobs that defy the laws of gravity, so that proves that women are considered objects in video games. I don't know what voice that was. I apologize. It just came out of left field. My throat is drying up. But there are even more sexist structures in video games than the armor. Don't know what you're trying to say here. Even though that armor often looks like someone trying to lasso two twin zeppelins. Okay, maybe boobs are a little bit big. But then, so are men's muscles. What's your argument here? Oh, well, women are grossly outproportionate. So are men in video games. Yeah, sexism goes both ways. It's not just women who are sexualized, it is men as well. And if you don't think that a man can be sexualized, then try to explain to the firemen why their calendars sell a lot. The physical character design can obviously be sexist. In fact, that's usually its entire job. But often, it's narrative structures that wrap the player in a matrix of the sexism matrix of sexism. Is this like a red pill, blue pill sort of thing? Take the blue pill and you go back to the dream world, take the red pill and you're in the matrix of sexism? Because that's about as fantasy as you can get. And these are the six most common. So, we've got daddy issues. Some recent games had featured independent, well-developed characters with amazing powers, intriguing paths, and mental off-switches activated by ball sweat. It's like the player has kryptonite testicles. Do you just not like men? Is that your problem? Do you just not like cock or testicles at all? BioShock Infinite's Elizabeth was born with the ability to tear portals in time and space, then learn to pick locks anyways, then sat patiently in prison until a penis arrived to save her. Okay, even if you could break the space-time continuum barrier and travel anywhere at any place, how did she get in jail in the first place? Clear if she got in jail the first time, then no amount of her power is really going to help her. So yeah, maybe she needs to get saved. I'm just saying, I haven't played the game, but that would be my first response to that. Maybe you can give a little bit more background on some of this before just jumping for the attack. Ellie from The Last of Us. Ooh, Naughty Dog. I think I just reported on how they want stronger female representation in video games. I could be wrong though. Is immune to apocalyptic virus. Learns new weapons faster than Neo. Again, the whole matrix set of sexism. And has stabbed more enemies to death than Wolverine. X-Men sexist? I don't know. But as soon as the guy turns up, she dissolves into tears and nursing. Now, she could be a machetifying a rapist cannibal into sashimi, but if the hero arrives, she'll instantly collapse into helpless tears, safe in his arm, because that's exactly what happens. I don't know if you know anything about war, but that kind of shit does happen. You can have a soldier that fought in the Vietnam War. He killed the enemy. He did everything that was ordered of him. He was highly decorated as an officer in war, or a soldier in war. And then the moment he goes home and actually thinks about the shit he does, he has trouble grasping onto reality. He could have been tough as nails Marine in the Vietnam War, but the moment he comes home, he cries a lot. That shit happens. In a post-apocalyptic world, I can actually see that happening very easily. But oh no, if a girl shows any cojones at all, then she is a badass. But if she shows even one little tear, well, she's just a sexist symbol made for the man that comes and helps her. You are a moron for thinking that. The protagonists, on the other hand, are such anonymous manly men that we're not even going to bother with their names. Yeah, that doesn't seem sexist towards men at all. The last thing anyone would describe me as is manly. Don't have bulging muscles, a nice six pack. I'm not the envy of any man ever in this universe. And yet I play a man just like that. That doesn't seem the least bit sexist as to a far good representation of what most men are. But hey, it's not sexist if it's for a man, right? You already know they're white, stubbly, grizzled, dark hair, gun platforms. Well, I've never really shot a gun except in the military. I do have dark hair, a goatee, grizzly. Oh, and I'm white. But I'm certainly not that guy. Their only advantages are magic balls that fix them as they center on the narrative of the universe. Really? My testicles are magical? Does that make them magically delicious? And they've already lost their own girl earlier, because why on earth would a man care about a woman without prior cause? Oh, so if I've lost a loved one in the past and then find someone who's in need of my help, especially if they're female and need my help, the only reason why I'm helping them is because I loved someone else in my life? Again, you're an idiot. The woman's struggle becomes a stand-in for the man's loss. Her entire narrative is just a piece of his, and scribes, daddy makes it all better all over her ending. Yeah, that sounds really gross. Probably should be arrested for writing shit like that about a child. There are father-daughter relationships that work because the daughters in question are actually children. For example, Clementine is not equipped to cope with the horrors of the zombie apocalypse in Walking Dead. The little sisters of Bioshock 2 need a literal big daddy to protect them from rampaging splicers. And that's not exactly a daddy-daughter relationship. It is more of what we call a symbiosis effect. Look up that word, symbiosis. But if the woman can already rip holes in reality and or any enemy sternums, maybe they should have a character dynamic other than save me. Yes, because every girl in video games should be a one-man army that can do everything herself. And that's a true sense of reality, that no one ever needs help. Even Solid Snake needed help from Otacon and Meryl Silverberg. The next segment is the damsel, showing a picture of Princess Zelda and Link. The damsel in distress has been thoroughly covered in Anita Sarkeesian's infamous Tropes vs. Women videos. Really? You're going to make reference to her? I won't discuss my personal feelings about her now, but not a good starting point if you have to cover her just to make your point. But in case you missed those, the damsel is a character captured just so the dude can save her. Are you talking about Jeff Bridges? Does Jeff Bridges need to save the damsel in distress? I don't ever remember seeing a game about the dude saving the damsel in distress. In fact, I think the movie The Big Lebowski, I mean, he did try to save someone but proved that they weren't actually kidnapped. The bad guy bursts into her life, destroys everything he sees, and carrying her away. Then he abuses and tortures her just so some dude, the dude again, can put his courage to the test to come save her, often in an attempt to reclaim her as some sort of love prize or symbolic victory. This often involves the same kind of smash everything and carry the woman technique utilized by the villain in the first place. But it's okay because it's your turn. The woman is passed back and forth like a football and you're trying to get into the end zone. Anita wasn't this crass. I may not like Anita, but she does bring up some very good points, and she's very tasteful in most of the things she says. This right here is, hey, I agree with Anita, but let me go to a further extreme than her. Ha ha ha, all of the feminist girls will think I'm a genius for doing this. And I'm sorry to say, but I have not once ever seen a video game that says, okay, well, now that I've rescued you, I'm putting you on the shelf there. Now, that right there is a football trophy, and that's my bowling trophy, and you're just going to sit there. But I thought maybe we could get married and have children and live happily ever after. This is no fairy tale, baby. I only saved you because I wanted a trophy. Now, just sit up there and look pretty and try not to get kidnapped again. A character is a damsel if she can be replaced by an inanimate object without any changes to the plot. Mario could just have easily been trying to grab a golden pipe wrench or find a gas mask so that he doesn't hallucinate so badly when cleaning blocked sewage lines in the pharmaceutical animal testing labs. Do you feel like maybe they're trying to address another issue, trying to sneak something in here? I don't know why people keep using Mario Brothers as an example of sexism in video games. It didn't even have a complex narrative. We don't have enough information on the narrative. All we know is that she's the damsel, but we don't know how she was kidnapped each and every time. We don't know if she's just enjoying it. We don't know if she hired Bowser to do it. We don't know anything about this because it's such a simplistic story. Hell, she might be trying to get away from Mario and wants to marry Bowser, but Mario doesn't see it that way. We generally are seeing the game from his viewpoint. Mario might just be too stupid to realize she's trying to leave him. Again, we don't know. Use something other than Mario Brothers. The reason they're problematic, note that that's the classy grown-up way of saying fucked up. Problematic is synonymous with fucked up. Are they assuming that children are reading this? Because if they are, they definitely need to go to jail for trying to introduce sexual concepts such as penis and testicles to children. It's because this trope, it's not a trope, it's a plot device. Trope doesn't mean what you think it does. It's technically about the capture of a woman, but it evolves to be about the man, and the woman becomes a plot device. Oh, you didn't get it right. I apologize. To get him through a glory-filled narrative. In over a dozen Zelda games, Zelda has only helped Link save her a couple of times. The games are named after her, but she might as well be a key card in a dress. Something he needs to grab to win. Except key cards perform a function in the game. That's just awful writing right there. And it's clearly someone who hasn't ever really analyzed the Zelda games. Let's take the first Zelda game. Now, on a sheet of paper, Link has to collect the Triforce pieces, defeat Ganon, and save the princess. But if you actually look at the story that's presented in-game, and if you haven't seen it before, just don't touch the controller for about a minute, and then it'll show you the story and all of the items you can get in-game. It's really interesting stuff. But there's also the story in the game book. Now, in the analysis of this, it shows that Princess Zelda was aware she was going to be kidnapped. She knew it was going to happen. So, she knew that he would also get the Triforce of Power. So, she took the Triforce of Wisdom, broke it up into 8 pieces, hid it in 8 labyrinths to prevent Ganon from getting it, and then told her nursemaid, Impa, to go find someone to collect the pieces to defeat Ganon and to rescue her, so thus rescuing her kingdom. This tells me that she had the intention of knowing that she was going to get kidnapped, and she could have done something to stop the kidnapping, but she would have ended up sacrificing her kingdom. Instead, she chose to get kidnapped to protect her kingdom. She chose the responsibility of her title as princess. She chose her own people above her own life. Now, in all honesty, this is behavior that we should be encouraging, not just in women, but men as well. We should be celebrating Zelda for what she did in this game. But we don't. Plus, mention, you know, it's just the male power fantasy, even though Link is technically a boy in the story. And in all honesty, if you look at a lot of the games, Zelda does help out quite a bit. And she's not completely helpless, but oftentimes overpowered. Are you saying that no female should ever be overpowered, whether in a physical sense or a magical sense? And that overpowering a female is sexist? I mean, if I'm going to be an evil villain and try to stop the hero or kidnap the princess, I'm going to try to overpower either of them in some way to ensure my success. There's nothing wrong with a hero rescue tale. Oh, I'm glad we're in agreement. Article's over. Oh man, there's more. But it doesn't always have to be boy saves girl. The days when superior physical strength defined who did what ended the instant we created virtual worlds disconnected from reality. The days when superior physical strength defined who did what ended the instant we created virtual worlds disconnected from reality. Try to use a comma somewhere in your sentence. That sentence is just bad. If you can teleport by playing the Ocarina, then you don't need a testosterone to swing a sword. Yeah, the Ocarina didn't necessarily defeat all of your enemies. All they'd be doing is like, hey, cute tune, bam! So, kind of having a sword and swinging it. By the way, women also have testosterone. Just thought you might want to know that. An alternative view is presented in Hope, The Other Side of Adventure. This free mobile game takes 5 minutes each day to make you the captured princess awaiting the arrival of her prince. It's short, shocking, heartbreaking, and most importantly, annoying. The entire time I wanted to shake her so that she could finally find a way to pay her own bills and say her own name, and that's the point. The damsel in distress is frustrating gender trope that needs 100 cc's of Destiny's Child stat. If the game's annoying, stop playing it. Not every game has to be exactly perfect to your definition of what a game should be. Find a game you like and play it. The dominant turns submissive, and of course they show Samus here. Growing up, I had two ass-kicking female models I wanted to be, Samus Aran and Lara Croft. Sorry, Eleanor Roosevelt, you should have killed a zombie or something if you wanted to leave an impact on me. Really? Eleanor Roosevelt left no impact on you in your entire life? Whether you're male or female, Eleanor Roosevelt should have left some sort of impact on you, and if you need zombies to be killed in order to have some sort of impact on you, you're in need of mental help. And I like Samus Aran and Lara Croft as much as the next person, but these are fictional characters. Focus your life on a real character and become a better person for it. Lara might have moved every ounce of her body fat into her breasts, but she was still an intellectually and physically capable character bringing twin handguns to every ass-kicking. So if you look like Lara Croft, then you're just awful. Unless you're packing twin guns, then you're badass. So moving on, Samus Aran was a tank that could somersault and explode everything underneath before she landed. The fact that her gender surprised so many people at the end of the first Metroid should have started us on the road to fixing these gender problems over 20 years ago. It did. Because here's the kicker. If there was only one Metroid game, then I would agree with you that it didn't do anything for the cause. However, every iteration of Metroid after that, people knew they were playing a female character and still loved to play the game. Point in fact, Metroid M, the first Metroid M, is celebrated as one of the highest ranking Metacritic games ever. So Metroid did have a positive impact on our culture and introduced the idea that females could be badass and non-sexualized. However, she is in a skin-tight suit, but I actually kind of suspect that that would be beneficial to her, especially if her battle suits respond to neural feedback from her nerve endings, that she would need something that was skin-tight. But, you know, there's nothing wrong with looking sexy at the same time, which neo-feminists seem to think is a crime against nature, except that when they do it themselves. But then it's our fault as men for thinking they look attractive. Oh god, it's just so confusing. Moving on. So, instead, since reboots have treated them like unsaved files, wiping out everything people spent ages developing, replacing them with blank templates, and filling us with rage, the Tomb Raider reboot reduces Laura to a puddle of tears. Every time she cried, missed a jump and then cried, or killed a person in self-defense, followed by crying, I wanted Laura Mulvey to spoon me and tell me everything was going to be all right. Yes, because Laura, in her origin story, was, you know, not as badass as she was, and was probably through her travels where she developed a tough skin to be able to handle that. But people are not born that way. People develop into that. I mean, some people are born that way, but it's actually more common that people develop this way over time. And we're seeing how she went from, you know, a fresh out of college girl into the tough badass that she was. Who cares if she cries a little bit along the way? That makes the game more realistic, especially from a psychological standpoint. Where's the sexism in this? I get that it's an origin story, origin, before Laura became badass, but when we saw young Indiana Jones at the start of The Last Crusade, it wasn't extended shots of him weeping and trying to wipe a snotty nose off his leather coat. Well, I don't remember that part in The Last Crusade, but you're kind of comparing apples and oranges here, in my opinion. I mean, you're trying to compare a movie media that has a short, limited time to do anything and didn't really have a whole lot of time to really explore the complexities of his character. The main focus was on Harrison Ford. And in this, we dedicated an entire game to her early life, to where we could explore the psychological impact. And that's the thing about video games over TV and movies, is that video games can spend time exploring this stuff. The developer said they wanted the player to care for Laura and protect her. Horseshit. I didn't want to protect her. I wanted to smack her and tell her to go get her shit together. Really? You want to hurt people? Wow, that's really kind of fucked up if you ask me. Oh, well, I get a joy out of hitting people and telling them to toughen up. Wow, and you're supposed to be better than me as a man? Well, I don't know what to say about that. I don't want to smack girls around and tell them that they have to toughen up. Also, imagine applying that to Halo's Master Chief, or nursing teenage Duke Nukem through his crippling insecurities. Why can't we celebrate her as a competent professional tested by unexpected situations? You know, like every other male character. Because, you know, when Solid Snakes goes through his trials, or Otacon, you know, we don't want to see that. We just want to see them kicking ass in any instance of their personality showing through. Oh, that's just a crime against women. Men do it too. You're just not naming those examples. Other M replaced Samus, the most badass bounty hunter in gaming, with doe eyes and daddy issues. She single-handedly exterminated invasive species and exploded entire planets, but now she'll stand in lava and burn to death before switching on her shields without permission from Commander Father Figure, who calls her Lady. The story was so staggeringly sexist that even Team Ninja, the group behind Dead or Alive sports games, where women with big breasts larger than the volleyballs go on dates with your voyeur photography, announce, whoa, that wasn't us. I see what you did there. You start talking about Samus, and you're trying to raise a good point, and then try to steer it into some other point you want to make. Yeah, I mean, you're sitting here talking about dominant women turning into submissive and then try to sneak in beach volleyball into the conversation where it doesn't belong. Makes your argument rather weak. What's even more infuriating with other M's is Samus responding to a distress signal from an infant Metroid that she calls the baby. She has guilt over the baby. She believes the baby was crying for her. She feels that the baby enhanced her abilities. The baby, the baby, the baby, the fucking baby. What's your point? We call creatures by names, by pet names. And she happened to call it the baby. She saw it hatch, so it's natural that she sees it as a baby. She might even have some maternal instinct for it. But what is the issue here? Are you saying that a woman can't do this? Oh, we're feminists now, so you can't call a small infant creature baby. That's going to hurt us in the long run, so you need to call it something else, like roadkill. Yeah, let's call it that. Or the thing that sucked life out of people, or a vampire. Let's call it those things. But baby, oh no, we can't do that. That is just going to hurt us in so many ways that you cannot imagine. And for you to do that, you're just hurting the cause. Wow, I know I nitpick, but damn. That's just awful nitpicking right there. Because that's how all women think, right? Early Metroid games had a maternal aspect, with the hatchling Metroid saving Samus' life, but that was subtle. To picture how badly Other M ruins it, replace all of the Ellen Ripley dialogue in Aliens with constant rape whistle. What? To picture how badly Other M ruins it, replace all of the Ellen Ripley's dialogue in Aliens with constant rape whistle. Do you want to expand what that means? I mean, I haven't played the Other M games, but I don't imagine that there is an element of rape in these games. So, can you explain that to me? Go on further? Because it seems like you're trying to make a really good point here, and I am patronizing you on that one. But, I mean, you leave it off of that, and then you go on to your next point. This is bad journalism. Now, I do have to cut the video here. This is actually going to be pretty long. So join me in part 2, where I discuss issues 4, 5, and 6, and then give a final conclusion of everything that I've read. Until next time,